this is what action-adventure television was like before 9/11.
Dang.
Dang.
This is what action-adventure television was like after 9/11.
Go ahead and do it, Jack. Get it done. Shoot me.
Do it!
You know, Jack Bauer could be a real drag sometimes. A real bucket of worms. '24 was one of my favorite shows of all time. I loved it, and so did millions of other people, and so did the White House. Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, Karl Rove, Michael Chertoff, they all loved it. John McCain was even in it. See, there he is, a war hero and a senator, in between his two runs for president, jumps at the chance to play some agency stiff with the TPS report. So let's run the numbers on this show we all loved so, so dearly. With a ton of help from the site Wiki24, I counted up every character across the show's 9-season run who actually had a name. Not like terrorist henchman or FBI agent number 2, but a real name. I found 283 of them. 121 of them died. If the writers bothered to name you, there was nearly a 50% chance they were going to kill you. Now, on average, you would hang out for about 11 hours before you died. Odds are you'd only last about 3 to 6. But hey, on the bright side, you had a pretty decent chance of hanging around after they killed you. While I was at it, I counted that up too. There were 40 instances in which a character appeared on an episode exclusively as a corpse. 24 reimagined America as a sort of hell on earth, a place where you went to worship death, a country undeserving of anyone's love or loyalty. If you set foot in this hell, you were almost guaranteed to suffer. Jack Bauer's America was a death cult. And it was the funniest death cult on television. The best introduction to the 24 universe is to experience it through the eyes of a normal, real-life person. And this nice lady is going to find him for us. His name is...
Joss!
I hope you never forget where you were the day you met Joss. J-O-S. Not Josh. Joss. He is the least important character in the history of American fiction. I guarantee it. Come on out, Joss. Here he comes, the man himself. Just an average Joe like you and me. By the way, you know his name is Joss because his shirt says Joss on it. Thank you, Joss. I wish all television characters were that helpful. Okay, you know what? I walked all over his introduction. Let's rewind the tape and do this again. You ready, Joss? Sorry, Joss. Let's do this again. Here he comes, the man himself. Just an average Joe like you, and he's dead. That lady was a terrorist, but Joss was just some random dude. He was never mentioned before or after that scene, he had nothing to do with anything, and his death did nothing to forward the plot. If you were wondering how long a normal person like you or me could survive in 24 world, there's your answer. 4.2 seconds. Our kind cannot survive in this world. It seemed like on 24, the more innocent you were, the worse it was going to be for you. Let's go back to that chart. You see that character who appeared in not one but two episodes as a dead body? Well, meet Debbie. She was played by Leighton Meester, and she appeared in about 6 minutes worth of scenes as an alive person. She was a teenage girl who was super nice to everybody, never did anything wrong, and loved her boyfriend. Problem: her boyfriend's parents were terrorists, so his mom poisoned her to death. She spent 30 seconds in the throes of death, and for the final 10 minutes worth of scenes, she was a dead person. She appeared for longer as a dead person than as an alive person. Basically just a prop, lying around like a beanbag while evil terrorist family figured out what to do with her body. There's Debbie's corpse visiting the desert. There's Debbie's corpse being shot by the terrorist mom even though she's dead already. There's Debbie's corpse's phone ringing at an inopportune time while her mom comes snooping around.
No, she downloaded that ring specially. It's one of her favorite songs.
Wait. What's one of her favorite songs? This? Debbie's corpse, your favorite song is the music from SimCity 2000. Debbie's corpse, you are such a nerd corpse. Here's my theory on Debbie. 24 writers love to kill, and they were a little pissed off when they couldn't kill someone. They weren't allowed to kill Kim Bauer. She was off limits because she was Jack Bauer's daughter. So they were like, okay, we'll write a stand-in. We'll write this other teenage girl who's even more blameless and innocent and naive. And then they took her and they made her die in a terrible fashion. They shot her after she was already dead, and then they buried her in the damn desert. No, I said buried her in the desert. Beruz, where are you going? Beruz, where are you going? Get back here right now, young man. Where are your manners? Bury your dead girl. You know what? Fuck it. Whatever. Beruz is actually pretty smart to run away from everything and everyone in this show. I did some looking up and I found 18 men of Middle Eastern descent on this show who were fleshed out well enough to have a first and a last name. 17 of them died. The other one was last seen barely clinging to life in a hospital bed after being beaten within an inch of his life. But black president can't be racist. Debbie and Joss try to fly under the radar, but the more normal and reasonable you are in this show, the more you stand out. Let's now consider the characters we've actually heard of. These are all the characters in the main cast, like the ones major enough to find their way on a DVD box. Not including repeats, that gives us 45 major characters, and almost half of them are dead. Three more suffered some kind of permanent debilitating condition, seven more are serving lifelong prison sentences, and a few of those are going to die for treason, eight more lost a close loved one, like a spouse, parent, child, and that leaves eight characters out of 45 who escaped the show relatively intact. If you were a major player in the 24 universe, there was an 82% chance that your life would be ended or destroyed. Honestly, if the writers didn't destroy you, it's probably because they just hadn't gotten around to you yet. At the center of it all was Jack Bauer, the conduit of all human suffering. Now, what kind of suffering exactly sort of depended on who he was to you? So I divided the people in Jack's life into five major categories. First up. This was a bit of a judgment call, but I narrowed this list down to 12 primary sidekicks. People who were not only trusted allies of Jack, but folks who were actually going out there and taking it out and chopping it up with him. Bad things happen to almost all of them. They range from getting knocked out with a headbutt, to getting shot and buried alive, to getting their hand chopped off, to straight up getting murdered. These folks paid a very high price for being on Jack's team. I mean, these are horrible things to do to somebody. Who would do such a thing? The answer is Jack would, and there was always a reason. A couple of times these people ended up being traitors, other times he had to do it to maintain a cover, a lot of times it was because he just didn't trust him to understand his mission. If you're close to Jack, you should think of him as a chimp. He's very interesting, and he will rip your arms off. But none of them had it worse than Paul Raines. Poor Paul, man. We've got to talk about Paul. So, Paul is married to Audrey. They separate, and Audrey gets with Jack. And Paul's like, "White Audrey, I love you." And Audrey's like, "Nah, man, you're pretty much Mr. Bean." And then some terrorism shit happens, as it tends to do. Jack finds out that coincidentally, Paul has intel on a terrorist. Paul resents Jack for taking his girl, so he won't talk to Jack. So Jack gets out a lamp cord and electrocutes his nipples. April Fools, I made that part up. Sorry. I actually didn't make it up. Sorry, April Fools again. So Paul just got his nipples electrocuted by the boyfriend of the woman he loves while she watched. His ego is annihilated, but he's a good dude and he knows about computer shit, so he goes on a mission with Jack to help him with computer shit. And once again, we're treated to the spectacle of a man who looks a lot like Mr. Bean getting his ass kicked. Roll that beautiful Bane footage. But then, Paul becomes one of the few people to save Jack's life. He pushes him out of the way and takes a bullet for him. So after this act of heroism, Audrey says, "Paul, I've been thinking, and I do want to be with you."
With me?
Okay, I'm Mr. Bane.
So then Paul's wheeled into surgery, and it should be over. It's not over, because Jack busts into the operating room with a pistol, points it at the surgeon's head, and says, "You stop operating on Paul so you can operate on this terrorist with intel."
Are you crazy?
And finally, it's all over. Because Paul's dead.
Phew, he was just shit wall to wall from Mr. Bean there.
The trend's pretty clear by now, right? In 24, if you're a good, upstanding person, you won't just be dead. You'll be humiliated and sad and dead. Because the 24 universe hates you. Now, if you know anything about Jack Bauer, you know that he's very anti-authority. By the time he hit season 6, he mostly just stopped having bosses altogether. The bosses he did have were sacrificial lambs. Two of them suffered the death of their children, and the other 6 died themselves. But this is what's weird. They sacrificed their lives. And I don't mean they just went into a dangerous situation and happened to take a bullet. I mean they did things knowing they were guaranteeing their deaths. Jack hated those bosses at one point or another. Every single one. But they all did something that Jack himself was never able to do, no matter how hard he tried. They died.
Jack was supposed to be the one to fly that nuke into the desert, but George Mason stowed away in the plane, gave Jack a parachute, and told him he'd fly it the rest of the way.
Brought something for you.
And this is where he said some of the realest shit anyone on 24 has ever said.
You want to die. You've had a death wish ever since Terry died. The way things have been going for you the past year and a half, this probably doesn't look like such a bad idea.
It's true. I mean, a lot of 24 just concerns Jack trying to die. A couple times he begs to be executed. Several times he goes on what seem like absolute suicide missions. A couple times he actually did clinically die for a few minutes only to be resuscitated. But that was the rule everyone watching understood. Jack Bauer was not allowed to die. His existence was hell. You're not allowed to die in hell.
Come on, Jack.
Both entrances are blocked. We are boxed in.
That's Jack Bauer. He's coming for me. Kill him.
Time for a very brief presidential history lesson. Ever since John Adams took over for George Washington, most transfers of power have been pretty normal. A president's terms are up, or he doesn't get reelected. The ones in red are the abnormal transfers. A president died in office, or resigned, or something like that. Now, from Nixon's resignation up until the 24 universe began, things are looking pretty smooth, right? Let's put it in the capable hands of 24, nothing bad will happen, everything bad happened, oh no! This show detailed 11 transfers of presidential power, and of those, 10 were abnormal. If you were living in this universe, how could you see the presidency disintegrate like this and not just assume America was dying? Now, these presidencies ended for all kinds of different reasons. You want to guess the most common one? It's not assassination. It's actually the funniest reason I could think of. They didn't want to be president anymore. They just quit. In the middle of being president, they were just like, "Fuck this, y'all, I'm gone."
You know what? I wouldn't want to be president in 24 either. Because you know why? 24's God was a bored 8-year-old who hated them.
Hey, it's David Palmer, everyone's favorite. He's the best president ever. What a badass.
But it will destroy you.
Let's kill him. Ah, shit, man. I wish I didn't kill him. Damn. Okay, y'all. New season, new president. Let's see who it is. It's David Palmer again. I'm just joking. He's fine. He's such a good president. I promise you, Palmer, we won't mess with you anymore. Do you have an ex-wife? Let's punch her in the face. Shoot her. Okay, seriously, you guys, we have to be super serious about the next president. They don't grow on trees, and we have to take care of them, okay? Let's shoot down his plane.
Yeah.
I'm not going upstairs until it's safe.
Well, shit, I wouldn't have shot down his plane if I knew his vice president was a shitty knockoff Nixon. Man, you know who I miss? David Palmer. Man, he was so good. What a great president. Oh, hey, you're Palmer's brother, right? You want to be president? You got it, man. You're the president. Knock him dead.
Took an oath to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution.
Oh my god, you're such a nerd. I'm sorry, I have to blow you up. I'm sorry. So, who's your vice president? Powers Booth. All right, Palmer's brother, get back in there.
I'm not being very clear. Let me say again.
Oh my god, you're so boring. Smell you later, nerd. Well, shit, do we even have any living presidents left? Oh yeah, Nixon, everybody's favorite shitty president. You're the worst. Let's throw food at him. Boo.
Stab him.
This show treated presidents like items to be consumed. 24, supposedly a pro-America show, took the president, supposedly the most dignified American, and dragged him behind the shed and stabbed him and blew him up and shot him and beat the absolute fuck out of him. That's why I showed you all that. This show has no value system. It believes in nothing. Okay, you know what? Just one more, okay? President, middle of the soccer field, walk around. Yeah. Oh, God.
You son of a bitch, Jack! You son of a bitch! I hate you, Jack!
Jack had 6 love interests over the course of the show. 5 of them died. The other one, Kate, well, as for her, she was someone close to Jack who didn't suffer death or tragedy, so she was basically a complete anomaly. It's almost as though the show forgot to kill her. I counted 16 people close to Jack who appeared in multiple seasons. 4 more lost a close loved one, and the rest of them died. I think Jack might have suffered more than any character in the history of fiction. Like, not television, fiction. It's just absurd. And yet, what I want to argue is that all of this is completely appropriate. This should be a living hell. It deserves to be, because 24 is an attempt to transplant an absurd narrative into a logical world. They're completely incompatible, and the result is chaos. And it all started right here. On March 4th, 2003, the first act of 24's second season wound up. Jack Bauer and friends had just prevented a 9/11 scale terrorist attack, and they'd spend the rest of the season trying to keep the U.S. from waging a retaliatory war in the Middle East. But before he did, the show took a 3-week break. And during that break, in the real world, the United States waged a retaliatory war in the Middle East. Weapons of mass destruction were never found. No link between 9/11 and Iraq was ever established. Over the ensuing years, the White House struggled to explain why the war was being fought at all. More than 100,000 Iraqi civilians, according to an Iraq Body Count Project estimate, are dead. Within a few years' time, the majority of Americans would come to believe it never should have happened at all. And in 24's universe, it didn't happen. Against all odds, Jack Bauer and President Palmer managed to defeat a massive conspiracy and avert war in the Middle East based on false evidence. That's one fantasy 24 fulfilled. If you ask me, it's not the only one. In 24, the threats just kept coming, each one threatening to destroy America, and most of them missing a clear motive beyond we're doing a bad thing because we're the bad guys. And strangely, it seemed like every time Jack had to go rogue to defeat them. Sometimes he'd have a trusted friend or two, sometimes he was all by himself. He was David, and the enemy was Goliath. And that right there is how Jack fulfilled our American fantasy. America is Goliath. But in Jack Bauer, we could reimagine America as David. And the thing about Goliath is that they always want to be David. You see this all the time. White folks crying reverse racism, evangelicals with skidoos who feel persecuted like the Apostle Paul. Men's rights activists claiming that men are oppressed, Patriots fans who say nobody believes in us even though they win 5 Super Bowls a year, straight white kids and loving families who feel like the world is against them because they're left-handed and scissors are difficult to use. That last one is me. And that's how Jack Bauer fulfilled our fantasy. He was our reimagination of America as David. We wanted to be the little guy and the big guy. We want to be both. We don't really get to do that. It's so fundamentally absurd that it's entirely appropriate that the 24 world was a perpetual, fatal, exploding, hellish pile of rubble, rejecting it like a Civil War hand transplant. And we're here. This is the part where the sum of Jack's suffering is supposed to all be worth it. Well, these are what I figure to be Jack's great enemies, the one he spent several episodes or even seasons trying to bring down. I counted 23 of them, of which Jack only killed 8. You know who was better at killing the bad guys? The bad guys. They offed themselves more often than Jack killed them. Now, it's true that some of that bad-guy-on-bad-guy violence was precipitated by Jack's actions. They felt the walls closing in, and they turn on each other. But a lot of it wasn't, and that's led me to this really depressing truth. That if Jack didn't exist, the 24 world wouldn't really be very different. There would still be an onslaught of bad guys, sure. By 24's logic, terrorists are terrorists because they're terrorists. Traitors in our government are traitors because they're traitors. How can they be gotten rid of if their existence is illogical in the first place? Without Jack, they would just keep on coming and coming forever. With Jack, it's the same deal. He just delays fate. Jack Bauer spent all this time sweeping leaves on a windy day. And by the end, it felt like he knew it. So it's toward the end of the show. Jack's out on a mission, and he gets a phone call. The last of his lovers is dead. He falls to the ground, puts down his assault rifle, and pulls out his pistol. We know what this means. So there's this Calvin and Hobbes strip that's a favorite of mine. Calvin's standing at the bus stop, right? He hates school. He hates getting up early. He's pissed off and he hates his life. "I hate everything," he says. "I wish I was dead." And then he catches himself. "Well, no, I don't. Not really. I wish everyone else was dead." Decided to spend its final few minutes not securing salvation for its long-suffering hero, but doing what it always did, destroying Jack a little more and killing everyone else it dragged on screen. The morning after this man's head fell off, Jack boarded a helicopter and spent the rest of his life in a Russian prison. Kiefer Sutherland has said he has no interest in resuming his role as Jack Bauer. That was it. We'll probably never see him again. Someone once visited the set of 24 to warn the producers that the show's depiction of torture was giving bad ideas to real-life American soldiers. He later said, "I'd like them to stop." That someone was Patrick Finnegan, Brigadier General and Dean of West Point. At one point, Carlos Bernard, who played Tony Almeida, was at a baseball game when somebody told him, "Hey, Carlos, all I can do is watch that show of yours. When are you coming back?" That someone was President George W. Bush. On 24's depiction of torture, someone once said, "Jack Bauer saved Los Angeles. He saved hundreds of thousands of lives. Are you going to convict Jack Bauer? Is any jury going to convict Jack Bauer? I don't think so." That someone was Supreme Court Justice Scalia. Another quote from someone who found inspiration in Jack Bauer. "Jack Bauer knows sometimes there's only bad choices, and you've got to make the least bad choice, and he takes responsibility for it. And that's frankly something that I think is great aspiration." That's Homeland Security Secretary Michael Chertoff. Chertoff actually once attended a Heritage Foundation event that celebrated 24. He spoke at the event. Carlos Bernard was there. Mary Lynn Rayscoop, who plays Chloe O'Brien, she was there too. Rush Limbaugh hosted the event. With the cameras rolling and in the middle of the event, he kissed Rayscoop, a kiss she would later confirm she was not expecting and did not want. She seemed taken aback by the proceedings as a whole.
"I got into acting to avoid politics of any sort, and so I could remain in a fantasy world, and you guys are kind of bringing me out of it, so..."
It was weird. It was really weird. White House-level endorsements of TV shows had to that point been an enormous deal. But between a cameo, a visit to the White House, and an event keynoted by the Homeland Security Chief, no show had been celebrated by our nation's leaders like 24. The bloodiest, saddest show television had ever seen. It was a show about endless suffering and endless futility. It reduced America to a cathedral of death worship. It killed the good and the evil, but it took special joy in devouring the unaffiliated innocent. And our leaders were in love. Jack Bauer was their guy. Jack Bauer was the most miserable human being anyone has ever met, been, or imagined. Hey, Jack, you know what? I just realized we haven't heard you say a single word this entire time. You've been kind of quiet, you there?
Yeah.
Cool. So I was wondering, you know, I wanted to ask you what this experience meant for you. It must have been such an honor being the modern John Wayne, the 9/11 Clint Eastwood. Did you enjoy your time as the, are you proud of, You know what? We can do this another time if this is a bad,